Hello students, let's begin the second part of the chapter The Delhi Sultans. Here we talk about the architecture. Delhi saw many monuments being built during the Delhi Sultanate. The most famous of it is the Qutub Minar, which was built during Slave Dynasty, that is the first dynasty of Delhi Sultanate. There are few others which include Alai Darwaza, Siri Fort, Hauze Khas, Tughlakabad Fort, Mehrauli and some other areas of Mehrauli. Even Agra was also built during the Sultanate period, and we all know the Taj Mahal of India is known worldwide. Many mosques were also built during Delhi Sultanate rule. Now let's come back to the book. The Masjid. A mosque is called a Masjid in Arabic, which means it is a place where Muslim prostrates in reverence to Allah, where the Muslims do their prayer, they perform their namaz, we all know that. In a congregational mosque, it's also known as Masjid-e-Zamai or Zama Masjid, Muslims read their prayers, that is namaz, together. The members of the congregation choose one of the most respected learned man as the leader and they call him Imam. And he is the one who performs the rituals of the prayer and he delivers the sermon during the Friday prayer. And the sermon is known as Khutba. He delivers Khutba every Friday. During prayer, Muslims are supposed to stand facing Makkah. Makkah is their holy place. And India, this is to the west. So the Indian Muslims, they face towards the west to do their prayer. This is called the Qibla. The Delhi Sultans built several mosques in cities all over the subcontinents. And what does this show? The very first thing is it shows they claim to be the protectors of Islam and Muslim. The second thing, the mosque also helped to create the sense of a community of believers who shared a belief system and a code of conduct. Now, under them, there were many Muslims who came from a variety of backgrounds. So, to make them understand, they are one, they are united, they are together. This mosque were built so that they can come together and then pray together under one roof. Now let's take a closer look at administration and consolidation under the Khaljis and Tughlaq. Now, Delhi Sultanate had a vast area, so it was very difficult for them to rule. So they needed reliable governors and administrators. They were not in favor of appointing aristocrats and the landed chieftains as their governors. So they have their special slaves purchased for military services. They are called as Bandagan in the Persian language. They were carefully trained and then they were given important positions in their office, in their kingdom. And this people, or you can say this servers, they were dependent upon their master, that is their Sultan, and Sultan fully, completely trust them. They were very loyal and very faithful to their Sultan. Now, the Tughlaq and the Khaljis and the Tughlaq continue to use this Bandagan, and they raised people of humble birth, whereas often their clients to high political positions. Many of them were appointed as generals and governors. Now the slaves and clients were very loyal to their masters and their patrons. New sultans used to have their own servants at different positions in his kingdom, which was not liked by the old and the new nobility. There was always conflict between the old and the new nobility. And this was also mentioned in the history. The historians have mentioned the authors of the Persian Tawarikh. They have criticized the Delhi Sultans for appointing the low and the base born to high offices. This was not liked by them. Now let's come to the next page. Now, sultans like Khalji and Tughlaq monarchs, they appointed their military commanders as governors. Because the area was vast and to take control of them, the governors were appointed. These lands were called as Iktas, and their holder, the one who was taking care of them, दिस लैंड वॉज कॉल्ड एज इक्तदार और मुक्ति. वट वॉज द ड्यूटी ऑफ द मुक्ति? द ड्यूटी वॉज टू लीड मिलिट्री कैंपेन्स एंड टू मेंटेन लॉ एंड ऑर्डर इन देयर इक्तास. दैट वॉज द वर्क टू बी डन. नाउ इन एक्सचेंज फॉर देयर मिलिट्री सर्विसेज द मुक्तीज कलेक्टेड द रेवेन्यूज ऑफ देयर असाइनमेंट्स एज सैलरी. ओके, दे ऑल्सो पेड देयर सोल्जर्स फ्रॉम देयर रेवेन्यूज. वॉट एवर रेवेन्यूज दे यूज टू कलेक्ट दैट थ्रू फ्रॉम दैम दे ऑल्सो यूज टू पे देयर सोल्जर्स. कंट्रोल ओवर मुक्तीज वॉज मोस्ट इफेक्टिव इफ देयर ऑफिस वॉज नॉट इनहेरिटेबल एंड इफ देवर असाइंड इक्तास फॉर अ शॉर्ट पीरियड ऑफ टाइम बिफोर बींग शिफ्टड. सो द कंट्रोल ऑफ वन गवर्नर और वन मुक्ति वॉज मोर इफेक्टिव इफ दे हैव दैट कंट्रोल ओवर दैट एरिया ओनली फॉर अ शॉर्टर टाइम एंड देन दे वर शिफ्टेड टू द अदर वंस अदर प्लेसेस. दिस हार्श कंडीशन ऑफ सर्सेस वर रिगरसली इम्पोज ड्यूरिंग द रेन ऑफ अलाउद्दीन खिलजी एंड मोहम्मद तुगलक. नाउ अकाउंटेंट्स वर अपॉइंटेड सो दैट दे कैन टेक केयर और दे कैन कीप अ चेक ऑन द अमाउंट ऑफ रेवेन्यू कलेक्टेड बाय द मुक्तीज. केयर वॉज टेकन दैट द मुक्ति कलेक्टेड ओनली द टैक्स प्रिस्क्राइब बाय द स्टेट. नो एक्स्ट्रा मनी शुड बी कलेक्टेड बाय देम एंड वी कैप द रिक्वायर्ड नंबर ऑफ सोल्जर्स. नाउ एज द दिल्ली सुल्तान्स ब्रॉट द इनहेरिट लैंड हिंटर लैंड ऑफ द सिटीज अंडर द कंट्रोल दे वर फोर्स्ड टू हैव द लैंड चिफ्तान्स एंड द अदर्स एरिस्टोक्रेट्स अंडर देयर अथॉरिटी. दे डिडंट अलाउ them to lay any tax. Whatever tax was being laid by them, that was cancelled. And then they were also forced to pay tax. The Sultan administrators measured the land and kept careful account. There were three types of taxes. One was on the cultivation called khiraj and amounting to about 50% of the peasants produce. Whatever the peasant produce, that's 50% was taken as a tax. Second was tax on the cattle, and the third was tax on the houses. It's important to remember that the large part of the subcontinent remained outside the control of the Delhi Sultans. It was difficult from Delhi, sitting at the Delhi and controlling to the southern India or to the parts like Bengal and all. So the entire region became independent. Even the Gangetic plains, they were forested areas that Sultan forces could not penetrate. Local chieftains established their own rule in these regions because it was very difficult for them to control from so far off place. Rulers like Alauddin Khilji and Muhammad Tughlaq could force their control in these areas, but only for a shorter duration. Okay. The Mongols under Genghis Khan invaded Transoxiana in northern East Iran in 1219, and the Delhi Sultan was faced their onslaught soon after. Mongol attacks on the Delhi Sultanate increased during the reign of Alauddin Khilji and in the early years of Muhammad Tughlaq's rule. This forced the two rulers to mobilize a large standing army in Delhi, which posed a huge administrative challenge. Let us see how the two sultans dealt with this. That's on the next page. You can have a look. You can read it out. He is about Alauddin Khilji and he is about Muhammad Tughlaq. So you can have a thorough reading of this page. Let's move on to the end of this lesson. The Sultanate in the 15th and the 16th century. Now, Tughlaq and the Sayyid and the Lodi dynasty ruled from Delhi and Agra until 1526. By then, Jaunpur, Bengal, Malwa, Gujarat, Rajasthan, and the entire South India had independent rulers who established flourishing states and prosperous capitals. This was also the period which saw the emergence of new ruling groups like the Afghans and the Rajput. During that time, many of the parts they had their independent rulers and they were flourishing. Some of the states established in this period were small but powerful, and extremely well administered. Sher Shah Suri, who ruled from 1540 to 1545, started his career as the manager of a small territory for his uncle in Bihar, and eventually challenged and defeated by the Mughal Emperor Humayun in 1540. And then again he came into power in 1555 to 1556. Between this, Sher Shah Suri took over. Sher Shah captured Delhi and established his own dynasty. Although the Suri dynasty ruled for only 15 years, that is between 1540 to 1555. It introduced an administration that borrowed elements from Alauddin Khilji and made them more efficient. Sher Shah's administration became the model, followed by the great emperor Akbar. Now, the Mughal emperor Akbar, he admired the administration of Sher Shah Suri, so he also followed it. So with this, the chapter ends. Hope you understood it. If you have any doubt, you can contact me. Thank you.